organization. We're all volunteer run and based. And what we're fighting for is a healthy environment, so environmental justice, defunding our police department, fighting for justice for our population, fighting for justice for our unhoused community. Going out into the community and giving these folks a voice. And the facet of work that I do within the organization is working with our unhoused community and doing housing and homelessness work. So I am actually the director of mutual aid outreach right now. And we are going to encampments all over the Los Angeles area, providing basic services and helping people meet their needs who are living on the streets currently, and also finding and trying to build up leaders who are actually on the streets, because we should not be building or pushing forth any policy on housing and homelessness without the input of our unhoused brothers and sisters. So tonight we are very, very lucky to be joined with two members of our team, Lloyd Edward and Ayman Ahmed. These are two of our unhoused folks who are very important to the movement. Do you guys want to introduce yourselves really quick? Just do your name, your pronouns.
My name's Ayman. I go by he, him. I'm unhoused in Echo Park currently. And
Lloyd?
Hello, everyone. My name is Lloyd Edward. I go by he, him. And I am currently in a hotel room, part of Project Room Key, which is an initiative by the mayor to house unhoused people during the COVID-19 pandemic. But I still consider myself homeless as I still visit my encampment where I spent a year or so living in a tent at Echo Park Lake along with Ayman.
Thank you, guys. I also wanted to pass it over to Bill really quickly because he is the executive director of our merged organization with Ground Game Power. So Bill, if you want to give us a little overview of the work that Power does.
Yeah, thanks, Ash. I'm in Lloyd. Thank you, John, everyone. Great to be here. Thank you for having us. Yep, I'm Bill Przlucki. I'm the executive director of Power and Ground Game in Los Angeles. We're affiliates of People's Action Network and part of the Homes Guarantee team. And we've been working as an organization since basically our founding in 1999 on issues relating to housing and affordable housing, creating and preserving it, housing policy, land use policy, and also issues around community safety and community accessibility, and basically who gets to be part of the community and how policies impact different members of our community. And I just think the only thing I'll say about our work right now is that, you know, we were sort of born in Venice, California, which is one of the places in Los Angeles where there's a large unhoused population. And from the very beginning, we've understood that, you know, housing and homelessness are not separate policy issues. It's a continuum of issues. And actually, like, there's no way that we're going to really get to a homes guarantee where we have a human right to housing for every person without addressing issues around homelessness and working to help and organize and turn into, you know, move into leadership folks who are unhoused in our community. At the end of the day, that's where the leadership that's going to get us to a homes guarantee comes from. And, you know, a huge piece of that is, like, we can't talk about this issue without talking about the mechanisms of social control that defend private property and that enforce these class and racial hierarchies that create homelessness as a social issue and enforce the bad solutions to it. And namely, that mechanism is the police, right? We're just, like, cannot get to a homes guarantee without talking about the police. Ash, John, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you so much. And I really appreciate that point. It's so important that as we think about defunding the police, we have to think about all the folks who are housed in our jails, the ways that police impact our unhoused population. But I want to really dig into some personal stories and really, like, understand how you all came to where you're at. Lloyd, can we start with you? Could you talk a little bit about how you got to work with Ashley and Bill and Ayman and the other folks at Power and Ground Game?
Sure. My name is Lloyd Edward again. I'm originally from Kansas City. I lived in Kansas City all my life. And I moved to California, and I've been homeless for approximately 3 years. I recently moved to Echo Park Lake, which was the first time that I got introduced to tent living. A tent was donated to me by a good friend of mine. And I was referred to Echo Park Lake, which is a park here, pretty well known here in Los Angeles. And I soon became part of an encampment there at the park. And so immediately we started having to deal with police harassment and just constant harassment from law enforcement. And we were proactively trying to find solutions to, get some type of solution to move forward, or just a way for us to communicate with the people in power, that we were getting harassed, that we were acting in good faith, and that the criminalization of homelessness was apparent, and we tried to do that, and Ashley is how I met Ashley through that movement, and I met a gentleman by the name of Jed Perriott, who is part of Street Watch LA, who was helping our encampment deal with this constant pressure and harassment from the city. So some of the proactive steps that we took was to write an open letter, which Ashley was very actively involved in. We sent it to our local councilman to set up some type of one-on-one meeting for us to find some common sense solutions to move forward, where we could stay at the encampment without dealing with further harassment. And the point here was, you know, we weren't criminals. We were human beings just trying to find a better life. And if anyone knows anything about LA, we have a huge housing crisis here. And we have a homeless crisis here as well. We were just trying to make that apparent to everyone who lived in Echo Park, and also with his Mitchell Farrell, the councilman in the 13th district here in Los Angeles. So here we were, holding press conferences. We were very proactive as an encampment. Iman, who's there, was one of the leaders and still is, with that movement, where we were meeting with ABC, NBC, Fox News. The media would show up to our encampment. We would be very outspoken. And because we started finding out that that was the only way that we could get in contact with the people in power. They weren't willing to communicate with us directly. They refused to give us a seat at the table in any part of their discussions. And we eventually, personally, I was able to finally sit down with one of the field deputies who works for Mitchell Farrell, where I had a one-on-one meeting to discuss some of our concerns. And as we found out, the councilman, Mitchell Farrell, had met with certain constituents, but who were complaining about the encampments, and had never, in good faith, tried to set up a meeting with the homeless. So we were in this constant tug of war with that situation. And to add to that, we were dealing with police harassment, where at night, law enforcement would show up about 10 to 15 deep, knock on our tents at night, at 11 o'clock at night, approximately, to wake us up and tell us that we're not supposed to be in the park, that the park was closed. You know, we had a 60-year-old women there that were once teachers. You know, we had people with disabilities, you know, that were just trying to struggle and get by. So we were really proactive in protecting our small encampment, and we were also fighting on behalf of the homeless people in Los Angeles as well, because it was just an issue where our concerns were never looked at. They were the people in power, whether it was the mayor, whether it was the councilman, they never paid attention to our queries or to our concerns. So fast forward to that, while we're dealing with that, and that included us meeting with the police chief of Los Angeles. Keep in mind, this is an encampment of homeless folks. We were able to actually have a sit-down meeting, which Iman, who's there, was in that discussion, in that room. And so those were part of our efforts to try to find common sense solutions to for us to be able to move forward and stay in that park. It was all to no avail, but we fought hard. But fast forward, COVID-19 hit, and that happened when we actually sent an open letter to Mitchell Farrell, letting him know that we were concerned about COVID-19. And now we have not been dealing with police harassment as much. But Project Roomkey, and I'm almost done, I don't want to take too much time. Project Roomkey was an initiative pushed by Mayor Garcetti to help homeless people here in Los Angeles deal with the COVID-19 pandemic by putting the people who had health concerns and that were more prone to having COVID-19. And so that's the reason why I'm one of those folks here in the hotel right now. But the way that I got here is what I've always had an issue with. I barely got here because I ended up being part of a conference call, much like this one, where I was directly contacted by the heads of outreach programs who were in a rush to get me a room. So many others are out in the streets and they're part of this program, but they haven't gotten a room yet. What about those folks? You know, so long story short, that's what, you know, my story is, you know, but while I'm in this hotel room and even before this hotel room, we decided to still help the homeless while I was a homeless man by setting up a program called Power Up, where we would charge people's phones and set them up for a stimulus check where the government was giving out their $1,200 stimulus checks, and we were helping homeless folks gain access to a laptop where they could apply. And so I'm very actively involved in that still. And we meet with homeless people about 2 or 3 times a week, and we relocate from Echo Park to other parks, to other areas where we find homeless folks, and we help them charge their phones, give them water, give them knowledge about, we teach them about COVID-19. We give out masks, hand sanitizers, and we also sign them up so they can get a $1,200 stimulus checks. And I'm pretty sure we've already signed up probably close to 70 people here in Los Angeles. So I'm very involved in that still. That's the of the story.
No, I really appreciate you sharing and being really vulnerable with us about, you know, the process and everything that you have gone through and the work that you're doing. It's incredibly powerful work, and I think, you know, we want to work in the housing movement to really recognize the organizing that's done with the unhoused and homeless people and recognize the power that's being built by actually serving people and helping them with their lives as well as building power. Iman, I wonder if you could talk just a little bit about your personal story and how you got to the position you are and working with Power.
Yeah, I guess my story with homes, I became homeless in LA about a year or so ago in Venice. I was working in hostels before that, ever since I left college, it's just been one big survival story trying to find a place to live until eventually I was let go and put outside. And then it was about adapting to being outside. And I remember that for months before I became homeless, I was sort of preparing myself for homelessness because I wasn't in a secure position. So I always knew at any point my landlord could kick me out, which is eventually what happened. So I would always watch the homeless around Venice and say what I would do better. And I bet if we did a poll, we'd be surprised at how many people are doing this right now. And one of the biggest things about being homeless that I personally saw was the amount of stuff people had. I mean, when you have a house, you have storage, but when you don't, you don't. So this is what kept them landlocked. So I always told myself, if and when I become homeless, I'm gonna ditch everything I had to the bare, you know, to the bare things that I needed. And that's what I did. And for the first 8 months, I was living outside gym lockers at a 24-hour fitness. Because, you know, I went into survival mode and said, let me put the stuff I need in the gym lockers, and then I'll just sleep outside with a blanket. And that's what I did. Just had a blanket in a backpack. And for those 8 months, I would only have a good few nights at a place before I would have to leave because of police activity or because someone robbed me because, you know, I'm just sleeping outside with nothing. So I had no type of security, but I do want to say I always felt safe because I did have God. And then fast forward after about 8 months of being outside, I meet somebody named Devon and we end up just sleeping on the concrete together. And that's when the police harassment really up. You know, you got two black guys up in Santa Monica and that's just not a good call. It's not a good mixture. So we ended up coming out to Echo Park and because we remember there was a big tent community. So we figured it'd be okay. Our first night in Echo Park, we're met with Officer Solario, who comes knocking on our tents, telling us we have to leave. We had just come there, we had just gotten tents, we thought we had just gotten security, and then we were like, dang. And I remember it was three of us eating some bread and hummus with all of our stuff packed, not knowing where we're gonna go, because we're already outside, we're already homeless. So where is it you want us to go at 12 a.m.? So we had all our stuff, we had just gotten to Vons, we're eating that hummus, and we just didn't know where to go. But we saw that the main homeless encampment was basically saying, fuck the police, we're staying. And then we're like, oh, okay, fuck the police. And then the next day, we meet Jed, that was he was a street watch mentioned by Lloyd. And Jed reminded me that I was human and an American citizen. And this needs to be really pushed out to the unhoused population saying, hey, even though you're poor and homeless, the Bill of Rights and the Constitution still applies to you. Because mm-hmm. I had forgotten that. Before that, every time we were kicked out, I would just leave. Like a wounded animal, I would just accept it. But then I was reminded of my rights and I was like, oh wait, where will I go? Where am I going to go? And that's when our fight really started. Fast forward like a week or not even that many later, because Ashley was working with Lasha. So she was coming by giving us water all the time.
And Lasha is the government agency that we have here in Los Angeles. It's supposed to be helping folks get into housing.
They're not.
Story for a different day.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say what happened. So the police were coming there harassing us and they were telling us to leave. And for weeks and weeks and weeks, they would post a notice saying that they would be doing this cleaning. But really it's a sweep to get us out of there. And we would stay on the church side of things, which is across the street from the park. But then one day they decided to get extreme and say that the cleaning was going to take 5 days. So we said, we're supposed to pack up our stuff for 5 days. Where are we going to go for 5 days that we're not going to be told to get kicked out? And then that's when we decided to fight them. And this is what I really want to say, because people think that being homeless, you can get yourself out of poverty. But how when I'm forced to become an activist and I'm forced to organize 60 people? We ended up sitting on tractors. We had news cameras and news stations everywhere. I didn't plan on any of this to happen. How am I supposed to escape poverty when I'm defending my right to exist in poverty? It's just like, was the craziest thing. And ever since we fought back on the police, I guess we ticked them off a little bit, and then tit for tat, like some schoolyard retaliation, they started harassing us more and more. Lloyd alluded to it a bit. We had about 15 cops out there one night, 15 to 20. That was very scary. Day in, day out, from day to sunset, always dealing with the police telling us to leave. It's just that because we were in a park and we had all these nice families with their babies walking by and we had organizations behind us, that the police couldn't do what they did to some of my friends up the road. That's probably pizza.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we ordered pizza. So up the road under the bridge underpass, Lloyd knows it, in Vons, they would get swept a lot because there weren't babies or families walking by, if you guys get what I'm saying. So we're really protected uniquely in Echo Park, so we're able to fight for our rights, but it just became a constant fight every day against the city. And then COVID hit and it kind of shut down and they opened up the shelters. But what ended up happening is for some reason, the city decided to defund the shelters and fund the police. So they took our showers away. And I'm at Ashley's house right now and I just took a shower because I had my braids undone. But the thing is, and I pride myself a little bit on this, ever since I've been homeless, I've been hygienic. I got myself in that gym and I've been taking my shower. So I might not have had a place to stay, but I've always been able to take a shower and shave. Then they cut it. COVID cut the gym, so now the gyms aren't open. And then the mayor cut funding to the shelters plus the mobile shower units. So now there's nowhere in the city for people to shower. So we built our own shower made out of 2x4s and like garbage can thing. And we have our own shower, but that's just one spot. And we're actually, and we got some angel investors and we're building another shower under the Alvarado underpass. But it's just insane that now the police who we've been fighting are funded even more off our shower money. It doesn't make sense to be unhygienic or stink. There's no point to that. And like Lloyd alluded to real quick, we had sit-down meetings with them, with the chief of police, sit-down meetings. He had his lawyers, we had our lawyers. It was a big old thing, and nothing came of it. And we still haven't met the local council member, Mitch O'Farrell, and we have asked and asked. At one point, and again, how can you escape poverty when you're fighting this and organizing this? We all became our own mini Martins and Malcolms, and we didn't have time to escape poverty. At one point, Lloyd was the head of a panel meeting in which it was like the most strange, it was like Lloyd here and Jed and then some old lady and the old lady was against us. And it was this whole thing. Remember how she said there was a naked man in her pool and that somehow applied to all of us. And this is like, this is just the ridiculousness we had to go to. But what it showed was when it came to community healing, there was no city involved and there was no police involved. It was just the community. Even the ones that didn't like us, at least they showed up to the table to talk and heal. But the police weren't there and the city wasn't there. So it's clear who our enemy is. I guess
yeah, pizza's that's here. Great. That's my story.
That was so powerful. And there was just so much in there. I'm wondering, and this is to everyone really, if you could talk just a little bit about, and you touched on a little bit, like the myths about the unhoused community. What people think versus what's real and how important it is to like really debunk those myths and humanize folks.
Lloyd, do you want to go ahead and go first?
Sure. Me? Yeah. So that was one of the main things that we fought for because the police were basically trying to create an image of the homeless as criminals, spreading lies that, you know, there were needles on the ground when no one did that. And as far as we knew, it was just people smoking marijuana. But other than that, like me personally, I don't do drugs or I don't smoke weed. I don't drink alcohol. And so we were just confused by those accusations. And I think it was Jed who actually brought up that term, the criminalization of homelessness, where the city portrays or creates this portrait, this image of the homeless as being criminals and scaring the residents that live in those areas, where those residents naturally, out of fear, would then back up the police. And I consider the police as just an arm of the system in hand, where whatever the protocol is, whatever the system decides, or whatever the city decides, the police are there to enforce it. So how do you get about that? You create what you call fear-mongering, where you create this image of these people doing drugs and they have needles everywhere. This lady, I was part of a panel, as Ivan alluded to, I almost like laughed because she said there was a naked Mexican man in the pool, you know, every morning at our apartment complex, almost accusing us for that. We were just confused by those accusations. So one of the things that we did, and that's something that I discussed with Jed privately quite often, we decided to create an image, a positive image of who we are. And the way to do that is to directly talk to the homeless instead of listening to what these people are saying. Excuse me. So we went on radio shows. That was one of our efforts of going out there, speaking to the media directly. We set up before pre-COVID-19, the good old days, we set up picnics, you know, get-togethers on Saturdays where we would invite people around the park and people who were residents to come by and talk to us. And it worked. People started, you know, talking to us directly, knowing who we were, you know, and realizing like, wait a minute, these guys aren't what everyone else is saying, you know? So I can say with conviction, with confidence, that we ended up getting the residents to be on our side after many radio shows and many moments of just talking to folks. And we were part of a neighborhood council meeting where I was part of a panel. They heard me speak. They saw how articulate, nice gentleman I was, in their words. So it was just like, wait, these guys are not, you know, this image that the city is portraying. And I think that that's what the city does, is they want to create this negative image of who we are as homeless people, so that way they can enforce the law in silence, you know? And so that's the scary part, you know?
Iman, you want to talk about that as well?
Yeah, I'll leave it at that.
Lloyd's right, you know, and I like the way he ended it with, that's how they're able to enforce in silence, is when they control the narrative. So they kept, I remember when we were fighting them in our protest, that a lot of police would be telling the organizers on our side, not knowing they were on our side, because they just assumed that, like them, all house folks hated unhoused. But they would tell these house folks on our side that we were nothing but animals or drug addicts and users. And none of us were using drugs at that point. Weed smoking, but that's a matter of opinion at this point, and it's legal. And, you know, I smoke weed, and I'll admit it right now. And I remember that what we're dealing with is liars. You know, when people think of police, they think these are upright because of what position they are, or the narrative fed between what is unhoused or police. They think the police are the upright, but we're dealing with outright liars. We caught them in lies. I personally videotaped the chief of the park rangers in a lie that can go into more detail, I guess, another time, or should I go into detail on it now? I caught him in a lie, and then I videotaped him, and because of that videotape, they decided to retaliate arrest, and I got arrested for smoking weed in California. You know how many people smoke weed in the park? How many sorority girls got their bottle of rosé open? It was targeted. But where else am I supposed to go if that is my front yard? So they paint this picture, and they try to demonize us, but in reality, it's just people doing their best outside.
I really appreciate that. I also wanted to talk about some of the myths, and it was addressed here in the chat, you know, that homeless don't want to be helped, or they made bad choices, or don't want to work. And if you could also talk about, like, you know, some of those narratives that you hear, and then really the reality of the programs. Another narrative we hear is, well, there's programs. Anybody who wants help can get it. They just need to, you know, go down to county hall. And so, yeah, if you could talk a little bit about how you push back in the reality of those narratives.
Don't mind if I take that one?
All right, go
really
ahead.
Quick? Yeah, and then I would love to hear from them. So I, for almost a year, I worked for the governmental agency that is responsible for handling homelessness here in Los Angeles County. Just so everyone knows a little bit of context about what we're dealing with here, we have over 66,000 people who are homeless in Los Angeles County right now. Obviously, rents are extremely high, and my job was, and my job still is, but with that government agency, was to go and offer services to people and to get them into housing programs. They had a force of over 400 people who are working specifically to help that population get into housing. Over the duration of my tenure there, which was just under a year, I got just over 100 people into housing, and that took like months and months of being on a wait list. And most of those people had gone through programs before and had been exited for whatever reason. People do want help, so that's just absolutely untrue. As somebody who, you know, currently with our outreach teams, we're serving over 1,000 people at over 100 different encampments. folks want to get indoors. People absolutely want to get into housing. People don't want to have to struggle for food and water and have to fight with the cops every day. They don't want to be living outside and have to fight for the right to keep good hygiene or the right to shower. So that's just absolutely untrue. And if you go out there and meet your neighbors and actually have a conversation with the unhoused folks in your area, they'll tell you about your experiences. And it doesn't take that many conversations to realize that, oh my gosh, this is just absolutely propaganda that the government is feeding you to get you to believe something that's absolutely untrue about our unhoused population. A lot of people have just had bad experiences and have become disenchanted with the system because they have tried really hard at some point, you know. And if you're trying, you know, day after day, week after week, month after month to get into a housing program, and people are saying, yeah, the government, absolutely, we're going to be able to do this for you, and then no results ever come of that, like, I would be disenchanted with that system too, you know.
I mean, there's like 28,000 shelter beds in all of LA, and there's 66,000 on outside. So even if all the shelter beds were full, there'd still be nowhere to go for one third of people outside. Mm-hmm. And the thing about the shelters is they're worse than outside. Outside's actually beautiful. Nature has its own system for keeping itself clean and hygienic. Outside, you're actually more safe than you were if you were in a shelter. Outside, you're more clean than you were if you were in a shelter. You know, in a shelter, you got 20 guys. You don't know where they're from. You don't know what kind of mental illness they have, all in the same room. At least outside, I could find my corner and stick to my corner. And that's what a lot of people do, because there is no actual help from the city or government, not real help, just platitudes and talking, that people just find their corners and sort of stay there.
That's why we have to talk about not just a right to shelter, but a right to housing, a right to have a home in the way that you want a home to be. Because a lot of the shelter programs, they're very corrupt, and they feel like prison to a lot of people. You have curfews, you're not allowed to go out, you know, you have to do certain things. And for some people, that's okay and that works. But there's no real holistic help. There's not like the services people actually need. They don't have help getting back on their feet or getting into a more permanent situation. So yeah, I mean, that was beautifully said. But Lloyd, I would love to hear what you have to say as well about like the missing things.
Yeah, and that's the reason why I was raising my hand earlier, because I saw that in the chat. And that's one of the things I kept bringing up every time they would have a press conference or on the radio shows or when I was part of a panel, is this idea of the homeless being lazy. You know, we don't care. You know, we don't care about our futures. You know, and it's not that. And first of all, you're not supposed to judge anyone. So I don't judge anyone for the type of, whether it's drug addiction, mental health that they may have. You know, we don't know what a person may be going through, you know, but many of them are asking help. I'm one of those people. And that's the reason why I was perfect for some of these discussions, is because I don't do drugs. I don't drink alcohol. You can't accuse me of that. Even if I were, you can't judge me for it. You know, it's not right. And I have a caseworker. You know, I've been working with two outreach programs to help me get housing. And I had waited about 7 to 8 months with no word, nothing. And apparently 7 to 8 months is nothing. You know, there's people who've waited 2 years, some people 5 years, even more. You know, and it's just like, you got a system that's just dragging its heels. It's unbelievable. Even this Project Room Key, where they're housing people, which I'm grateful that I'm in, you know, and that's one of my quarrels with the way I got in the room, you know, is like, there's only half of the rooms filled right now. You know, what's taking so long to put the other or fill up the other half of the rooms? You know, so people are waiting, and, you know, while they're waiting, they're depressed. You know, they give up on the system. I had given up, you know, and the way that I got on this in this room was I took part of a discussion where there were leaders of LA, some of them, the assistant to Mayor Garcetti himself. You had some heads of LASA that were there. And that's how they were able to hear my story. And I told them flat that I'm one of the people who's fallen through the cracks. And I feel as if I am not the only one. There's many other people that are out there that have fallen through the cracks. And while you're waiting and you give up on the system, you turn to drugs because you're depressed, you know, and it's just this horrible storm. It's a perfect storm. And with that, I'm going to end quick, is with you being in this perfect storm, you get judged, and then you get people who say, you know, they're not trying, and then you get law enforcement that come in, and then they harass you every day. So it's just like, you got a system that drags its feet, they take forever. We don't know what's going on, why they're taking so long. And that's part of the frustrations that many homeless people deal with, is a slow system. And while we wait, we are judged and harassed by law enforcement.
So yeah, I have one more question I want to pose to the group before we get into some Q&A, and then want to end with you guys talking about some of your vision. But I was trained as an organizer, like, yeah, we're not supposed to help people. People help themselves. We just organize to build power. Can you just talk a little bit about the care and the community and some of the support work that you are able to do and how you're able to build power through mutual aid?
Sure. I mean, you want to go first? Or you wanna, okay. If I hear the question correct, because I do want to answer direct, can you repeat?
Yeah, so just it's very different for folks to organize through mutual aid. A lot of organizers are just trained, like, we build power, we have leaders, but people need to help themselves. And so I just wanted you to talk a little bit, all three of you, if you could, about the way in which you use mutual aid and care work and support work to also build power.
One of the things I brought up to Jed was, how do we empower the homeless? You know, how do we get people to have a voice and have a seat for them to have a seat at the table? You know, how do we empower the folks who are dealing with this? And so, as I mentioned earlier, I started an idea with Jed, you know, starting a program locally in the park where we would help the homeless there. During the COVID-19, no one had access to computers because the libraries are closed. And here was this $1,200 stimulus check that people were entitled to, and they had no way of getting that. So we were able to build power through that by empowering our community. And keep in mind that it wasn't just homeless people we were helping. It was people who worked at the shower stop and people who worked in small businesses, or they weren't aware of the fact that they'd be getting a $1,200 check. So we helped them, helping the residents in the area who just wanted to charge their phones that day. You know, it wasn't just homeless people that we were helping. We were helping all kinds of people. And Jed and I started thinking about how can we empower the community even more. And now we are going into a different phase where we're gonna start helping, especially the homeless, with their ticket problems. You know, so if they get tickets through, you know, minor infractions, we act as a liaison between them and free legal services. You know, we apply for them over the laptop, and we hook them up, or we get a lawyer to come to the site to help them with their legal problems. So those are some of the things that we engage in. We just find a way to take the resources that we have and see how we can better utilize it to empower the people around us. And we take a different type of approach, because with all due respect, the caseworkers, if you haven't really experienced homelessness yourself, how are you really gonna connect with the homeless? I mean, you could be really good, but if you were there, I think you'd be even more effective. And so we're trying to find a way to empower the homeless that are currently living at Echo Park Lake, for example, to see how they can be or take part of Power Up for so they can help other homeless folks. So
that's great. I'll just keep an eye on the time. Let's hear from Ashley and Ima.
Absolutely. So I'll just keep this very short. So I am running a mutual aid outreach team right now, and my thing has always been quite simple. I just wanted to hammer this home for everyone. organizing and outreach go hand in hand, especially doing work for our unhoused population and in housing justice work. It's unfair to treat those two things separately, because if we really want to champion our unhoused leaders, we have to realize what their situation is. As somebody who's been formerly unhoused myself, I know what a struggle it is every single day to even, you know, get up and, you know, survive throughout the day. You know, we have people that don't have water, people that don't have food, people that don't have access to, you know, actual shelter, like even a tent sometimes people don't have. So I think that that's something we all have to be mindful of in continuing this work. We have to include our unhoused community, but we also need to help them survive. So for me, those two things go hand in hand, and I want to encourage everyone to go out and start meeting your unhoused neighbors, even if it's just one or two people. Bring some water bottles out, bring some like Ralph's gift cards or Vaughn's gift cards out. Be like, hey, what's up? I'm your neighbor. Like, what's going on with you? Who have you been talking to? Like, what are your goals for the future? Start there. And that will inform so many of the decisions that you make in this housing work and what you can do changing your community and their lives forever.
Yeah. And, you know, I think David, I didn't read the last name, but he wrote in the comments that lazy is a capitalist lie. And that's just so true. Just on the back question, I haven't met a lazy unhoused person. All day people are doing something. Diana is cooking all day long. We got people who can build in ways I didn't even know you could build. There's a lot of skill out here on these streets. It's just, if you define lazy under capitalist terminology, we now have to get a $10 an hour job. The $10 an hour job, or however the base wage is, 10.25,
15.
Is it 15 now? Okay, that's California. I'm from Virginia. It's $7.25 in Virginia, okay? And as a waiter, you don't even make that money. It's only tips. So what I'm trying to say is, if you have all these unhoused people, you put them back in the job market. The only job market there is base wage jobs. They have 80 plus hours. So I was looking from an unhoused perspective. I had two options: stay unhoused and work on myself so I can get myself properly out of this situation with my own skills and talents, or get a job and not be lazy under people's eyes. But that would mean 80 to 90 hours of shutting my brain off just to not afford in a house. Nobody wants to live that life. So people are outside working, but working under a different definition of what capitalist being of lazy is. And as far as the mutual aid is concerned, what I've noticed is that community outreach does way more than city pantering. So when you take a housed resident and an unhoused resident and just have them talk, like in the community potlucks that we did, where we just had upwards of like 100 people sometimes come out and their babies and everybody, and everyone realized, oh, we're all human. Nobody is less than, or nobody is too dumb to know anything. So at that point, we were all working together and we were actually able to get things done. All of our tents came from community outreach. All of our support and food has come from community outreach. The city hasn't done a thing. So it's important that you organize, but you organize through outreach and community building. That's what gets things done.
I think Bill had one last comment on this point.
Yeah, well, I just wanted to add, and Eamon, thank you for saying that, because that was the point I was going to make. I just want to put the political point on it, like just like your boss doesn't want men and women talking about how much they get paid in the office. Just like your landlord doesn't want neighbors talking about how much rent they pay. They don't want the housed community and the unhoused community mingling. That's why those acts of, before the pandemic, you know, the potlucks, and then after the pandemic, the mutual aid, that is actually also a form of political resistance and power building. Because like Lloyd was saying, it's like the police themselves who are out there literally with their own mouths perpetuating these myths. And that's all about the social control. Like that is the end game, is about keeping folks separate. So it's actually not that difficult to fight back, to take that first step, whereas literally just get to know folks in your community. All of us are neighbors.
That's so beautiful and so important, especially there's a lot of housing organizers out there that have a very high level of understanding of what justice might look like, but often aren't doing some of that work and aren't really like validating homelessness as much as we all should. So such an important conversation. Divya, did you want to start with some of the questions from the chat?
Yeah, I think we have time for two really good questions from the chat. The first question is from Bo. And he talked a little bit about his experience working in a homeless shelter and how bad the conditions were. Residents compared it to jail and prison frequently. And so his question is, are there example of wins organizing shelter residents to improve conditions? Yeah, how can we organize shelter residents to improve conditions? And just how is it similar and different to organizing renters against landlords?
So you're saying, how can we organize the shelters to be better for the people living in them?
Yeah, how do we organize the folks in the shelters to improve conditions within the shelters?
Well, I mean, there definitely has to be a screening process of some sorts, but just care. Actual care. All right, you can tell when money is being put towards something that someone cares about or when money is just being tossed at something. When I was in Venice, there was something funded by Charlie Sheen. Actually, he funded this. I forgot what it's called, but basically they fed the homeless like chef quality meals 3 times a day. I forgot what it was called, but that's where like money that was properly invested was put. And it was still homeless people there, but the energy was positive. So nobody was acting the way, I think it was the Rose's Kitchen right next to Whole Foods, right? Right around the corner, I think it was. So that was a way money was being invested with love and care, and that was being transferred in the overall energy. So everybody entered in a positive state of mind. It was just a joyful atmosphere. Fast forward to some shelters where it's just boom being thrown at. Here's a bed next to a cockroach. Nobody cares about you. Now that's that negative energy. And remember, the unhoused are already dealing with an issue of, are they a real citizen or not? They're dealing with an issue of positive outlook on who they are in life, if that makes sense. So when you put them in a place where the system's supposed to help them and the system shows by what they invested in or lack of investing that they don't care about you, that already adds to their bad state of mind and it just adds to an overall horrible experience.
Yeah, and I think that's beautiful. I think that is definitely something to take into consideration. But what I will say to that question, get to know the folks who are in the shelter, and I think it's going to look different just in terms of, you know, where the funding is coming from and who's running it. But the conversations that you have with the residents and what they need, that's kind of going to look the same as with renters. You know, find out what people need and what like giving that care would actually look like to residents there. So have those conversations, get to know the people that are living in those shelters, bring them together, have meetings with them, come up with a list of demands, and then find out what entity is funding them and petition that entity would be my advice.
Was there another question, Divya, from the chat?
Yeah, I don't know if anyone wants to weigh in on that question.
Sure. Cool.
Sure. I'm not sure what happened to my visual. But what I was going to say was, to answer your question, some of the problems that we dealt with shelters was belongings. A lot of people have a lot of stuff, and shelters oftentimes push towards you getting rid of your stuff. So that's one of the issues that I ran into. I have lots of my belongings and I have to throw a lot of it away. I have to compromise my personal belongings in order to stay in a shelter. Another one is the shelter kicking you out during the day. So, you know, certain shelters, they don't allow you to stay there during the day. You're just there to sleep at night. And then during the day you're out. So I think what we should do is focus on getting housing for longer terms instead of, you know, 3 months or 1 week and then you're out the next week, which is one of the things I experienced. Maybe setting up a 2-year program or a yearly program, something longer, long term, so that you can create a more stable housing for the homeless.
Awesome. Thanks, Lloyd. So the last question I think is a really good one from Blair and is a bit of a long-term dream visioning question. But Blair asks, people like Jamal Bowman and Naomi Klein and others are actively discussing the importance of working together to create a care-based economy. How do you all envision a dream like this, working on a large scale to address issues of homelessness in a deep and holistic manner?
If by care-based economy, they mean like an economy in which people actually care for each other, absolutely. Otherwise, this whole thing's gonna fall apart. an economy where the money is being put with actual love behind it, where the person's intention behind the spending is with empathy and care, that translates. There's an energy involved to it. And then the person receiving that investment, however it looks like, they're now more positive. You know, it really does determine where you stay. It's why when people go out to hotels, they don't want to stay in a bland hotel that's painted all silver, because that's going to put them in a down state of mind. It's the same thing with these housing and shelters. We don't want to just be another number and just be put on a cot, because then it puts us in a negative, weakened state of mind as well. And I would imagine, hypothetically, in a care-based economy, it wouldn't be so. And people would know your first name, and you would actually be treated like a human. That the very idea of curfews or just coming in at night to sleep, we're not animals, and that's what it makes you feel like. So in a care-based economy, the energy transfer of positivity and love would show itself, I think, in very great ways.
Great. Other reactions to that question?
Well, I just want to add one part, which is a little bit about how we get there, and it answers another question that was in the chat before too, which is on voting. Because another thing that we're doing and we'll be doing in November, we did it in March with our primary, was getting folks from Echo Park Lake and other encampments to actually participate in voting, because that's one of the ways, one of the many, many strategies towards getting an actual seat at the table and voice in the process, right? And getting that respect and having folks have to relate to you with respect. And one of the problems we encounter was that the provisional ballot you get when you can only register by a street intersection and without a number address, right, is that the down ballot stuff doesn't show up on your ballot. So the people most directly impacting issues of homelessness, like your DA, your city council member, like your mayor, they need to be on that ballot. So that's actually another one of the fights. I just want to throw that out there as like a little organizer red meat. There's some real good, like, policy-based organizing campaigns in here as well. And that all goes back to how we're also organizing for power by building an economy of care, an economy of mutual aid.
Oh, wow, that's really beautiful. I think we're probably gonna go a little bit over time, but there's one real practical question I saw in the chat. Christian Wade asked, like, what should I tell someone who says that the houseless do not want to be housed? So how do we respond to that question?
That's not true. That's just absolutely not true.
I mean, you can't make a broad statement for every person. You have to talk to every person on an individual basis. There's no way that's ridiculous. If the person says that, just tell them they're ridiculous.
Great.
What I would say is let people know that many of them do have caseworkers. They do work with outreach. They're connected somehow to some type of help to get housing. So it goes back to the point of creating this image of homeless being lazy and not being proactive in their own lives. Homelessness is not, to me, a way of life for many people. Certain people choose that life. Others, you know, many others don't want to stay in that. So a lot of us do work with caseworkers, with outreach programs to gain housing or try to take advantage of any resources that the city gives. The only problem is a lot of it takes a lot of time and the city drags its feet and there's just a long waiting period.
So yeah, I wanna close out. We talked a little bit about vision. But really, we're in this moment where folks are up in arms across the country about defunding the police, about abolishing prisons, and about really building a fundamentally new system. And I want folks to think about the police's role in homelessness and housing issues, and really, like, what could a world where we defund the police and have a homes guarantee look like? And I actually like all of you to address that for just a moment.
Maybe I should go first on this one because I want to let our leaders speak last and have the last word. This fight that we're in with our city budget right now, we just had a hearing this morning where LA Housing Authority, whose job is to prevent homelessness and provide housing, was voting on giving $9 million to the LAPD. That was resident services money for housing residents, not cop money, right? So additional monies to police. And as we think about this, like, defunding the police is one of the places that we can get that money to house folks. We did the math. It's something like we can like give everyone a hotel room or housing for like 3 years straight with the LAPD budget that's up for grabs in this year's budget. But the other thing that we can do is take away most of that downward pressure, right? Like folks who are on the street, unhoused folks, are actually far more likely to encounter police in a way that adds a ticket, adds a record, adds jail time. And that's the stuff that creates barriers to housing. So we can actually not only like get the money to pay for the housing itself, but also take away one of the main reasons that folks can't get into housing at the same time. That's the policy decision. And I want to turn it over to our folks to end it out with the human part of the vision.
Lloyd, do you want to go ahead and go?
Sure. Sorry, I got interrupted there. They serve dinner here at the hotel, and so I got to, and they do a temperature check and all that.
Lloyd,
so
actually, we'll talk about it later.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to, a life without, with defunding the police, I think is the way to go. And I think that will empower the community. It's going to put more control in the community's hands. And also, we're going to be able, I trust the community more than I trust the police. And I think that the community is going to be able to help the homeless more than the police would ever help the homeless. The police don't care about the homeless. I hate to make that broad statement, but they're in the interest of the city, you know, and the community, I think, has a better outreach to the homeless than the police would ever have. So defunding the police and empowering the community, I think, is the future.
Great. Thank you so much, Lloyd.
Amen. He said that amazingly. I can't even really come after that. I mean, yeah, you have to defund the police. And I do trust the community way more than I trust the police. And it is crazy to think about, because when you think about what the police were originally for, they were supposed to be community members coming to your door, helping you solve your issues if you had a cat stuck up on the tree or something. But instead, they're the strong arm of the city. They're the violent sword of the city. And the city is just in the pocket of the 1% and the people who are making these big old apartments no one can afford. So if you want to make an apartment that no one can afford, you can't have an encampment there. So how do you kick them out? You go to the mayor, and then the mayor tells the police, and then the police come with their big old guns and their gear and then their lies, and then they have this whole process to divide us. And yeah, you absolutely have to defund that. We just don't need that. I trust the community way more than I trust the police. And I also wanted to say too, with a homes guarantee, we have to decriminalize the concept of being outside. Yes, we want to put everyone in a home, but I was just talking to Ashley about it. It blows my absolute mind that in a planet that's got nothing to do with us, we didn't make this earth, we didn't make space, we didn't maintain it, yet all creatures get to live on this planet except humans. This squirrel can live outside, but me being outside is a crime, makes no sense. Yes, the goal is houses, but we have to decriminalize outside. That's crazy.
Wow. Ashley, you want to close us out?
Took the words right out of my mouth. I think that was a great way to end. Beautiful.
Perfect. Well, again, thank you all for joining us so much. Folks, I appreciate you bearing with us for an extra 5 minutes, but I really just could not end this conversation. And definitely will love to have you guys back on to talk more about this as we get deeper into it. But really want to make sure that we're all thinking about how we build a real holistic housing movement that isn't just about our issues, but actually building the type of communities that we want to live in, that we want to envision, being intersectional. And I hope that everyone takes this conversation and the next time, which you're gonna happen. You pass someone who is unhoused, you see them out there, you know where the encampment is, that you do just the basic thing of, maybe we're not starting a campaign, but just start a conversation. Yeah. And get involved in the care work that different folks are doing, because it's so important just to build those relationships, because we're all gonna have to hold relationships together, as they said so beautifully, between housed and unhoused folks, to build the kind of solidarity that we need to defund the police, win a homes guarantee, and actually get to the communities of care that the police are designed to stop us from having. So thank you so much for joining us. We'll be sending an email out next week with more updates about our campaign and when we'll be back on to do another edition. Also, feel free always to email homes@peoplesaction.org if you have suggestions for issues that we should cover in this space on a Homes Guarantee Thursdays. And again, thank you so much for joining us.